Today I'm I will talk about scaling Ethereum. Actually, we have the upcoming fork called EIP4844, which is the fork right after the withdrawal. And I will also talk about the dank sharding, which is the best scaling solution that we have right now. There is a misconception among the community that actually what we are trying to do in the near future is to scale the layer 2 of the Ethereum, but not the layer 1. So please keep this in mind throughout the presentation. Okay. Before talking about the about scaling Ethereum, we should know why Ethereum doesn't scale clearly. What will happen if we add like more transaction into the block? What will happen first is that the block size will be like larger, obviously. And that is not good if you don't have like much bandwidth. So the first thing is that you have a large block and you need more bandwidth to do that. And the second thing is that you have to execute the transaction. Okay, in addition, you can download my slide over there because this presentation is really technical in case you want to like go back and forth. The second thing is that you need more computation because you need to execute the transaction. And that is not good because it takes more resource and everyone has to do that. Like everyone need to download the block and also do the computation. Actually, this is how the optimistic roll-up lovely work. What we can solve, what we can scale with the layer 2 is that we don't actually need to do the computation. Like what you need to do is like you just send the layer 2 transaction inside the layer 1 block, and you also send the new state as well. Like it can be the root of the new state because it's quite short. And you just touch that the new state is the result of executing the transaction without actually executing them. You just like believe that is the correct new state. So in the Bitcoin node, you have a function to just receive the layer 2 transaction and the new state, and then you just don't have to execute the transaction, and you just keep the transaction and the new state inside the context state. So by doing this, you don't need the computational overhead at all because you just download the block and then you just store it. But it's still we still have a problem because the block size is still large because you have to keep the block size. You have to keep the transaction inside the block. So with the current layer 2, we can scale it to some extent, but there is still overhead in the block size. Yeah. So we need to solve that problem. And actually there is another function in the layer 2 context. It's like it's called a fork proof. Because as I mentioned previously, you have to touch the new state, right? That the new state is the correct state. But you don't want to always touch it, right? You have to somehow challenge that if someone send a long new state, you have to be able like to challenge it, right? So this is a concept of the fork proof. So what it does is like you send the fork proof and the block number of the layer 2, like if you to tell which block is the block that has a problem. Like for example, if I send the if the block number 2 has a problem and I send the fault proof, so the contact will verify the proof, and if the state, like the collect state, is not the same as the state that the block proposer sent, it mean that this state is not the correct one, right? So in that case, we have to penalize the block proposer of the block number 2, and also reward the challenger. Does that make sense? Okay, this is a fault proof. So we actually don't have to test the new state anymore, because if the new state is wrong, as in the in this slide, if the new state is wrong, someone will challenge it anyway, and they will get the reward. And you can see that this step, it requires some computation, because you have to run the EVM, and is that a problem? The answer is no, because you don't do this often. You do it only when there is someone want to challenge. Okay. If this state is long, you can just revert the chain and just start from the old state. This how the layers 2 scale clearly. But we want to scale more, because we want to reduce the block size. Okay. This is a simplified figure. So the problem of the big size is this one, right? The transaction, because it's quite big. What you want to do is just remove it. okay, we will remove it literally. So what you want to do is to replace the transaction with the commitment of the transaction instead. So we will not store the big transaction in the block, but we will store only the commitment of the transaction, like replace the transaction with the commitment of the transaction. And can we just do that? The answer is no, because in order to generate the fault proof, you need the transaction. You cannot know the transaction from just the commitment of the transaction. Okay, since the transaction, this one that I just said, so we will replace the transaction with the commitment of the transaction, but we will somehow, because the transaction I needed to compute the fault proof, as I mentioned earlier, the challenger must be able to somehow download the transaction. So in other words, the transaction must be available, but not in the block. This is called the data availability problem. We need to make sure that the transaction are available, or the data is available, so that we can generate the fault proof. This is the upcoming fork after the withdrawal, which will happen like at the end of this year or next year. I don't know yet, but it will be the next fork after the withdrawal. This is how it clearly this is how it will look like. So we will replace the layer 2 transaction with the commitment of the transaction. So the block will be very small now. Okay, the block is small now, but the block builder will have the block builder still have to send the transaction to everyone. So every beacon node will still need to download the layer two transaction or the data. So okay, the block size is small, but this problem is not gone, because you have to download the transaction. This is the EIP 4844. And if we cannot solve this problem, why do we do it? okay, it's good because it's good because at least we can make the box size smaller. Also the okay, I forgot to mention that in addition to receive the box, you also have the beacon node has also verified that the commitment of the commitment of the transaction has to correspond to the transaction. Otherwise, like it doesn't make sense. Like if it doesn't if they are not corresponding. The benefit of the 4A4 is that we can define our function, like it's the function is called like is data available, like given the beacon box, you can run the function is data available if this function is true. It means that this box is valid. It means that you can somehow get the data. Yeah, but if you cannot get the data, this function is false and this box will be invalid. And this function is trivial to implement in the 4844 because you have to download the data, like the whole bunch of transaction. So you can tell like exactly if the data is available because you download it. So it's like it's really trivial to do. Okay, how can we reduce the bandwidth requirement? Actually what we are going to do next is to not download the whole data, and we can still implement the is data available so that we can verify that the box is valid. We have a solution for that, like instead of sending the data into the network like this, we will divide the data into chunks or samples, like divide. And we will extend it like with the Lee Solomon Lecture code. Like if you don't know what it is, it's like you get the chunk of data and then you can extend it. Like double the size of it. And then the block builder will store them distributedly, like send them into the network, and then the network will store it. This one, the Lee Solomon Lecture code has a property that like if you have at least half of the samples, for example, this sample is missing, and you have only half of them, you can reconstruct all the samples like really efficiently. Why this property is good? Because you allow some sample to be missing, like to be unavailable, and you can reconstruct the whole thing from the partial information that you can download. So this is quite good that we allow some sample to be missing. Yeah. And how can we implement this data available? So because of that property, instead of just downloading the whole data to make sure that it's available, you can just download only like some constant number of samples. Like for example, if I want to download only like 40 samples, and this function is like true if all the sample like are available, and return false is if some sample is not available, like I cannot download like one of the 40 samples. This is quite cool because as I mentioned earlier, right, that that if you have at least half of the samples you can reconstruct the whole you can reconstruct all the sample. So if there are less than half of the sample that are available, the probability that is available is for is like at most like 0.5 to the 40, because if the sample if there are only less than half of the sample, when you query each sample, there is a good probability that you will not get it, like you will not get some sample, and that mean this function should return false if there are less than half of the sample. Any question now? No. Okay.
So is this method implemented yet?
Not yet. This
after the withdrawal.
No. The draft. The one after the withdrawal is this one, like for F4, you have to download. Download the whole data, the whole transaction.
Mm-hmm.
But with this solution, you can only download like
half of it.
Like yeah, like
a little bit more than half. Like at least half of it. Half of the sample.
No, you can just download like a constant number of sample. For example, if in the real implementation, there will be like 1,000 samples, and you have to download only like 40. So you don't have to download like 1,000 samples because of this property that okay. If you do it like this, there will be a really good probability that you will
be able to check.
Yeah. We'll be able to check this one.
Okay.
By download only 40 samples. This how the protocol look like. Instead of sending the layer 2 transaction directly, just as in the 4844, the block builder will divide the transaction like into chunks and do the extension. And then send them into the network, and the network will store it like somewhere. And when you want to, and when the beacon node want to check that the data is available, it can just download 40 samples. And if you can download all of them, it means that the data is available. But if you cannot download some of them, it means that it's not available. Okay.
Can I ask on that. So is the number of blocks accurate? So like it's doubling the data that has to be stored by doing
it. Yes. Yes. It has to be double. So yeah, so the bool chunks are the layer 2 transaction, right? And then when you do the least common code, you double it.
Okay, I see. So the storage would then be double for all the layer 2s that commit to the chain to L1.
Yes. Okay. But we don't think it's a problem. Okay. Because storage is cheap.
Storage is cheap. Okay. And can you know like what's the double looking like? It's not the duplicate, right? It's
No, it's not a duplicate. It's like some mathematically extension. And if you have a property that if you have at least half of them, you can reconstruct the whole thing.
So it's something it sounds like a like hard disk rate, where I don't remember the number, like there's a rate.
Yeah.
If you store extra data, then you can recover something, right?
Okay. Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Any more question after this? Like, no. Okay.
Okay. So okay. So sorry. So there is a small chance that there is an error in the if data available function, right? And how do you know if there is an error, or do you have to go back and download the raw data to check again?
There is the error.
Yeah, yeah. If there is an error, because there is small chance that the formula doesn't work, right? Really, really small chance. And how do you know if it happens or not?
So it's not zero chance. It's a small chance.
Yeah. Actually, this one is like it's not like all the samples are available. Like almost all the samples are available. You just return two. So you will have like there will be some like threshold. Like maybe for example, if I it may not be that all the 40 samples must be available. It may be just like 39 or 38. So we will give some error, but yeah, some error, like allow some samples to be unavailable. But if there are less than like 39 samples that are available, we just return false. Like we just conclude that the data is not available. That does make sense for this.
Let's say like you have like 100 validators.
Yes, yes, yes.
So statistically, you can't, that probability of getting that wrong is even less, because then all the validators need to return false data here for the block to be finalized.
Sorry, can you repeat that?
Oh, so I'm trying to like kind of extend
so
on
the
that.
The chance,
right?
Is like very, 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 very low
for a validator to say that a false positive, right, is low, and then you have to agree within all validators.
Yeah.
Like all validators, more than half of the validators or two third has to have this false positive for the block to be bad, or for the. Or not that case.
I don't quite understand. Like half. Okay. There may be some. Okay. There may be some validator that has a false positive, but it has very low probability.
Super, super, super.
Yeah,
super,
yeah.
Super low.
Like that's one. Like one in million. So the block builder has to make sure that the data is available, and if the block builder want to cheat and don't provide the data, it has a very low probability that the validator will return true, and the block builder will cheat because that with that probability. Yeah, that makes sense. Okay. This one, the Beacon node doesn't have to download the data anymore. Actually, they have to download, but only 40 samples. 40 samples instead of the whole data. So this bandwidth requirement is gone. Make sense?
Okay.
The next is the dank sharding. Like we can do better because the problem of this solution is that when you want to reconstruct the data, like you have to download at least half of this, which is still big. Like you have to download at least half of this and so that you can reconstruct all the samples, which is a lot. So it's still a big work to do reconstruction. So what we do instead is to do the dank sharding stuff. So instead of thinking of the data as an array, as a single dimension array, we you think as like a table, a two-dimensional array, and we will divide it into like chunks, two-dimensional chunks, and we will do the Reed Solomon code for each row, like do Reed Solomon code for this row and this row, okay, and we will do the Reed Solomon code again, like for this column. For this column, for this column, okay. By doing this, you can reconstruct the samples for some row and column, right? Because for example, if I want to reconstruct this row, like and like there are some sample missing in this row, I can download half of the sample of this row, and then reconstruct the row. Got it? Yeah. So by doing this, I can download only like half of like allow like square root of the number of samples. Like I can just download half of this row, which is a lot. Yeah, a lot like less, and yeah, it's quite good because but it's not like you can reconstruct the whole table. By downloading only this row, you can reconstruct this row, but at least you can help reconstruct. for example, there are some sample missing already, but you want to help like reconstruct this row. You can do it, right? Because you can just download this one, like download this one, and you can reconstruct the whole row, and it will come like this. Like anyone, like it's like anyone can help reconstruct the data if there are enough samples in the turbo, right? Because like just like the previous section that that in the single dimension you have to have at least half of the sample so that you can reconstruct. But if you have like if you don't have enough number of samples, is like you cannot reconstruct. Any question? Like on any slide?
So actually, this just check the availability of the data, right? It doesn't check like the data transaction, is it?
Yeah.
Just check the availability.
Because just check the availability. Like we, as you go back, this one. Just check the availability. But the transaction will be run only when someone generate a fault proof and then challenge it. Hmm. But in order to generate the fault proof, the transaction has to be available. So that like the challenger can download it somewhere, mm-hmm. and then like challenge.
I see. Okay. Thanks.
Any question?
Anyone?
What's the focus of research right now in the team? Like, what's the hardest? Like, or what's your pushing?
Currently, right now, everyone is focusing on Forever 4, like this one, like the every client team, like Lighthouse. Presume everyone is implementing this one, and it will be available like
at the end of the year.
Yeah, or next year, I don't know. in terms of the implementation, everyone is implementing this, but mm-hmm. on the research side, we have many projects. Like the sharding over here. We have something called proposer border separation, or PBS. It's like clearly the proposer has to be the one that include the transaction inside the box and then send the box to the rest of the network. But in the PBS you don't have to do that. Like the idea is like because when you want to propose the box, sometimes you want to do some kind of MEV things, and actually we don't want the every box poster has to run the MEV. So we separate the proposing responsibility with the box building responsibility, so that anyone can be a box builder by bidding to be the box builder for that slot, and the proposer will delegate the responsibility of building the box to the box builder. So the box proposer will still be randomized in each slot, but the box builder you can bid to be the box builder for every slot if you have enough money. And other things like we have some kind of single slot finality. Like clearly the finalization happen only every epoch or two epoch. I can't remember, but it's some kind of like one epoch. You have to wait for one epoch. One epoch is equal to 32 slots if you don't know. When the box is finalized, there is a security guarantee that box will not be like reworked. Otherwise there will be like a huge penalty for the attacker. But in the future we want to make the box finalized just only in one slot. That's what we call single slot finality. You don't have to wait for one epoch. That's called single slot finality.
Thank you for a very technical presentation. Very appreciate. I have heard somewhere, but cannot find the source. They said with sharding, the sharding will allow us to have a different EVM running on different chart. Is that true? And if that's true, how far from here to that phase?
Different EVM for different chart.
Actually, the idea of sharding is obsolete already. Like you can see that there is no chart at all. Like you can see it as like a huge data in a single box. So the design of the sharding is like obsolete already. Like there is no like chart one, chart two, chart three like this like that anymore. And yeah, actually because this one, right, the data is of the data that we want to make it available is actually the layer 2 transaction. So in the perspective of the layer 1, this data is like an opaque data. It doesn't have any meaning in the layer 1, but the layer 2 implementer can put the transaction to this data. So but in terms of the layer 1 is like you can just put anything in the data, like you can put the photo or anything, but it will be still expensive like to put something like that, like the photo, because it's quite huge.
On the researching perspective, what could this possibly enable?
What could possibly enable? You mean the application? The gas price of the layer 2 will be like a lot lower. and I think that's it. Like,
okay.
Like you allow more transaction in the layer two, and it also mean like more exposure to the normal people, I guess.
Okay.
As you mentioned that it can be allow more transaction in layer two, right? So if dank sharding is achieved, how many transaction or let's say throughput transaction per sec that can achieve? How many transaction that can achieve in the layer two if dank sharding is achieved? Can you just guessing the ballpark and estimate it?
I don't know about the number of transactions, but I can tell like because I don't know how big each transaction is like, but I can tell that the box size will increase like the data that you can store like in each box is like 300 times. Like because you need to keep the transaction in the box, but I don't know how many transaction you can put in. I don't have the data right now. Like what is the average transaction size? But the space that you can put the transaction is like 300 times if we implement the dank sharding stuff. Because we already set the size of this data to be like 32 megabytes, and the current box size is like 100 kilobytes, so it's like 300 times. Like, you can find the number of transactions now and then multiply it by 300.
Okay. So it will be 300 times faster. No.
More transactions.
More transactions, okay. Okay. So we have a very technical, in-depth sessions over here with a researcher from Ethereum Foundation itself. So please give a round of applause to Kun Pop Kapom. And